Please read this disclaimer. This video's all the character and all of its contents, including any disease and opinions expressed by the narrator, are strictly for entertainment purposes only. And it is not intended in any way as a substitute for professional service and consultation from licensed therapist, doctor, attorney, or other licensed professional service provider. Each person must make their own life decision, and those decisions are theirs. Hey listeners, welcome back to another out-of-the-world news story with Revolving Time. Today's story is about, could my loving wife be cheating on me? After a month of suspicions, trying my best to ignore the signs, I broke down and hired a private investigator. Well, go to the story and see how that explains it. 2 weeks later, when my pie comes back with a preliminary report. After 6 years of mostly blissful marriage, Gwen died in an auto accident. Our daughter growing inside her was taken from me at the same time. The teenage girl that ran the red light and broadsided Gwen's car was busy at the moment updating her Facebook page. Not only my pain, but Gwen's parents as well. They lost a daughter and their first grandchild. The 17-year-old girl, Catherine Mellon, was charged. I was ready to sit in court every day of her trial, holding a photo of Gwen and an ultrasound of my daughter. I was ready until the day Catherine Mellon's father came to visit me. It was 2 months after the accident. I was initially reluctant to meet Jacob Mellon when he called to ask for a meeting. I asked my grief counselor what he thought. My counselor was helping me recover, and after he and I discussed the pros and cons, I agreed to meet Mr. Mellon. Mr. Colina, thank you for meeting with me. Please let me begin by offering my condolences and apologize for the pain my daughter has caused. Is there a reason why your daughter isn't the one apologizing? Kathy wanted to come. I told her I should meet with you first. If you agree, she'll be here tomorrow. I assumed she's the last person you want to see. You're right. The only time I want to see your daughter is when the jury finds her guilty. Mr. Colina, I will do anything I can to prevent Kathy from going to prison. We're not wealthy people, but is there anything Kathy and I can do to avoid a prison sentence? Are you trying to bribe me with money? I was beginning to shout. Because if you think you can buy me, then duck you. I'm sorry, that came out wrong. I wouldn't dream of offering you money. I was told your wife was a nurse. I was thinking of a scholarship to nursing school in her name, something like that. I also want you to know that Catherine is accepting full responsibility for her actions. She's quite willing to plead guilty. She's willing to go to prison. It's me that's begging you to come up with a different punishment. I know what goes on in prison, even juvenile prisons. My daughter won't last a month in any one of those facilities. And yes, I understand that right now, you'd love for that to happen. For her to suffer, but I just can't let that happen. I could see Mellon was doing his best to hold back the tears as he spoke, but I wanted my pound of flesh. You have no clue what it feels like to lose everything. Maybe if you lose your daughter, you'll understand my pain. There's where you're wrong, Mr. Colina. My wife died 2 years ago to cancer. I watched her fade away after all the chemo and radiation failed to save her life. It wasn't the same. Her death wasn't caused by a thoughtless, stupid act. But, like you, my best friend and partner was taken from me. I do know how that feels. My anger for this man, who brought the girl into the world that took my family away, was starting to fade, just a little. Bring Catherine here tomorrow and we'll talk. I'm not making any promises, but I will meet with her. Update: Catherine came with her father the next day. Catherine's contrition and apology was genuine. It was an emotional meeting. The following day, I hired a PI to look into Catherine Mellon's life. The PI came back with information surprised me. Ms. Mellon was a National Honor Society student, a leader in her school with a wonderful reputation, and volunteered at the local hospital in the children's wing. After her mother's death from cancer, Catherine began spending time at the children's cancer ward. I also asked a few people in the know regarding Jacob Mellon's assertion that juvenile prison was as bad as he made it out. The answers I received was yes, kids like Catherine wouldn't come out of prison undamaged. So, now I had to ask myself, did I want this young lady's life ruined? It wasn't an easy decision. I talked to Gwen's parents, I talked to friends whom I trusted, I talked to my therapist. It was almost unanimous, let go of the need for revenge. Find a way to give Gwen's life and her death a meaningful turn. Gwen's parents were the most adamant, especially when I discussed Jacob Mellon's offer for a scholarship in Gwen's name. I met with the assistant dean and we came up with a plan. Catherine would plead guilty, she'd receive a suspended sentence, but if she was ever pulled over for inattentive driving again, she'd serve out her term. She would perform thousands of hours in community service, not just at the hospital, but also giving talks to students on the dangers of texting and driving. You listening about someone whose love turns to hate after a traumatic event such as infidelity, but I never considered the other side of that same coin, how someone could learn to love a person they initially hated. Now I know it can happen because after spending time with Catherine, my hatred for the young lady was melting away. I was learning to love her. No, not in a romantic way, but in the way an uncle loves a niece. By the time Catherine's hearing began, I was on board with the recommendation to suspend any prison term. I don't know who exactly came up with the idea. I think it was some do-gooder working in the sheriff's office, but someone thought it might have more impact if I appeared with Catherine at her talks on the dangers of inattentive driving. I had my doubts, but was convinced that even if these sessions saved one life, I'd have done my civic duty. Whomever designed Catherine's sessions did a fairly good job of it. The impact of each session would be increased because Catherine and I would be the presenters. We did a session roughly every 2 weeks at schools, churches, civic groups, and scout meetings. For me, it was another way I might turn my personal tragedy inside out. It was probably the 10th session when it hit me. I was watching Catherine give her part of that evening's presentation to a group of Boy Scouts when I realized. It was almost as if Catherine was getting some kind of rush from presenting her story of guilt and shame. I spent an hour with my counselor 2 days later, discussing what I saw and felt. He agreed there was every possibility that the sessions were becoming cathartic for Catherine. It wasn't that she didn't feel guilt or shame, it was she was using the sessions to deal with her inner turmoil. Whatever the reasons, I just couldn't be a part of the show and I quit the following week. Catherine and I lost touch with each other. She went to college to become a hospice nurse, of all things. Catherine sends a Christmas card every year. 3 years ago, she wrote that she got married. This year she wrote that she's going to have a baby in March. She asked if she could name the baby Gwen if it's a girl. I wrote back and told her I'd be happy if her child carried my wife's name. Somehow, it makes me feel better, knowing the young woman that took so much from me still cares and is trying to atone for that one stupid mistake she made all those years ago. Update 1. After I quit presenting these sessions with Catherine, my recovery took a setback. I started to drink. At least 4 or 5 evenings a week you could find me sitting on a bar stool at Donovan. That's where I met Haley. Haley, the bartender, became my close friend and confidant. She became my friend for 2 very good reasons. Haley always spent a few moments between serving other customers listening to my tales of loneliness, and, more important, Haley always gave me a heavy pour. Haley's a beautiful woman. She was a great listener, and not in that bartender looking for a big tip kind of way. She listened as I told her about Gwen, her death and my job. Haley and I seemed to have a lot in common, and I would have liked to ask her out on a date. But she had a boyfriend named Lonnie. Until one night when she started to tear up and told me she and Lonnie broke up because he kept cheating on her. That's all I needed to hear. I waited a couple days and asked Haley if we could have dinner together, somewhere away from this bar, just to talk. Haley looked at me with big eyes. Just talk. How disappointing. 3 nights later, I picked Haley up at the bar after her midday shift. She asked if I would give her a few minutes to change her dress before we went out. I sat and waited. Haley came out of the manager's office and walked to me, placed her arm around my waist and whispered in my ear, "Ready." Dinner was fantastic. Harry, I've liked you for a long time, but never did anything about it while I was with Lonnie. But Lonnie is gone now and I can't think of one reason why we can't go to your place and spend the night. Can you? Without finishing my drink, I stood up and pulled Haley up by her upper arm. I kissed her, grabbed my credit card off the table, and this time led Haley out the door while calling an Uber with my other hand. We were in my apartment within 10 minutes, and in bed, less than 3 minutes after that. That was the first night in the life of Harry and Haley. I worried we were both rebounding. It had been 18 months since Gwen died, but I hadn't really dated in all that time. And Haley had only been broken up with Lonnie a few weeks ago. Maybe we were moving too fast, but as I said, we just seemed to click on many levels and the sex was out of sight. We went out at least 2 nights a week and spent at least 1 day together every weekend beginning that night. I was dating a bartender, but drinking less. I didn't need to drink because the dark cloud I had been living under seemed to drift away. I cut back to a couple days a week at Donovan's. Haley moved in with me 3 months later when her apartment lease was up. With my new outlook on life came an unexpected byproduct. I received a promotion and substantial pay raise when my productivity increased. This was 6 months after Haley moved in and I called her to tell her we had a reason to celebrate. See if you can take a 4-day weekend off work next week. I want to take you out of town. Friday morning, we flew first class the first time for either of us to Miami International. I had a suite at the Marriott, right on South Beach. We ate at some wonderful Cuban restaurant and danced until 2 a.m. at a nightclub. We slept in Saturday morning before getting brunch, then to the beach for the day. Where do all these beautiful people come from? Haley fit right in with the beautiful people on the beach and at the clubs. At first, I thought I made a mistake bringing Haley to South Beach when an NBA player, who will remain unnamed, tried to pick her up that night while we were dancing. Any doubts regarding my plan for this weekend were put to rest when Haley shut him down with one sentence: "No, I'm here with my boyfriend." Sunday, another day on the beach, Haley surprised me by wearing a new bikini. We had dinner that evening at a nice, quiet, upscale restaurant. When the waiter brought our after-dinner drinks, I decided it was time. Pulling the small box out of my dinner jacket, I got down on one knee and asked, "Haley, will you marry me?" Haley looked at the 2-carat diamond, then in my eyes, put both of her hands on my head while getting on her knees in front of me and answered, "Yes." Do you know those stories when the guy asks his lady to marry him in a restaurant and all the other diners clap or whatever? Well, duck me. But I had to pick the one restaurant in the Western Hemisphere where every other diner has too many sticks shoved up their ducking as halls to even acknowledge what just happened. Worse than that, the maitre d' came by and asked us to please refrain from such displays. I paid the exorbitant bill, and we walked out. The small civil wedding in front of a judge took place 4 months later. For 7 months, life was a whirlwind of pleasure. Then it wasn't. Call me stupid, call me naive, call me gullible. Just don't call me a WP. Little things in my relationship with Haley started to change. Nothing I could point to at first and say, "Ah, that's it." But there were the little things which, if I wasn't so busy with my new responsibilities at work, may have been more apparent. Our sex life seemed to take a turn for the worse. Granted, married couples always make love more the first year of their relationship, but we were barely out of our first year. There were more unexplained hours every week when Haley didn't seem to be answering her phone or where I thought she'd be. Lots of little things, lots of things a man in love with his wife will try to find any other reason except for the real reason. Could my loving wife be cheating on me? Any man who has experienced and considered such thoughts knows the feeling. Please, anything but that. After a month of suspicions, trying my best to ignore the signs, I broke down and hired a private investigator. Update 2. Maybe this is a good time to give my listeners another small bit of information. Something I haven't shared until this moment. When Gwen was dead in that crash, not only did she have $250,000 in life insurance through her employer, the policy paid double for accidental death. The Mellon's auto insurance company paid another $500,000. All the money was sitting in a brokerage account. I never touched a penny of it. But I must have told Haley, my friendly bartender, about the money at some point last year when I was drinking and sharing too much. Which explains how, 2 weeks later when my pie came back with a preliminary report. "Mr. Colina, there's no easy way to tell you, but your wife is seeing a man by the name of Lonnie Douglas. I took the initiative to look into this Douglas character. He's been out of the state for the past year and a half, working down in the Gulf on an oil rig. He came back to town 8 weeks ago. He lives down in a trailer park south of town. That's where they meet a few times a week. We have photos of her walking in and out of his trailer, but no way to get a photo of the two of them together, intimate-like." Sorry, I was trying my best to keep from vomiting as I listened to the details regarding my wife's betrayal. I asked, "Anything you suggest? We can put a recorder on your landline." "But I wouldn't hold my breath waiting for her to use your landline as long as she has her cell. They never seem to meet at your home, so we're not going to get video of those two doing the dirty. Is there any way you can get her to use the landline? Maybe you can cancel her plan or something." "No, she still has her own plan and she pays her own cell bill. That's not going to happen. Give me a day or so and I'll try to think of something. In the meantime, put a recorder on my landline, just in case." In the end, I took the easy way out. Late Friday night, when I knew Haley would have to work all day, I took her phone and smashed. Saturday morning, Haley looked all over the house before she had to leave for work. On Monday, I listened to Sunday's recording. I had what I needed. Here's the transcript from Sunday morning's call. "Haley, what the duck? I've been calling you since last night. Why didn't you pick up or answer my texts? Lonnie, why are you calling me here? My cell phone went missing, and I called you yesterday from the tavern, but you didn't answer. That was you. I didn't recognize the number. You are in his hall. I need to replace my phone later today. I'll text you when it's activated. Haley, divorce him, get your half of his money, and let's get back to being together. I'm sick and tired of waiting here while you duck this is hall. We decided it would only be a year, and it's already been 15 months. But every time I think of you in bed with him, I lose it. If you don't make it happen in the next month, I'm out of here. Lonnie, calm down. Give me 4 weeks. I'll figure out a way to make the breakup his fault. Walk out with a $500,000, then you and I will be set for life. Please, baby, trust me. Before the year is out, we'll be together and loaded." The call ended, but I heard enough. How did I get so stupid? How did I get into a marriage with a bastard who only wanted my money? I was sad, but mostly I was angry. I barely kept it together as I went through the motions necessary to end it with Haley. My attorney was very intelligent. He knew what needed to be done. Haley argued in court that she nurtured me back to life after my first wife's death. My attorney countered that Haley's betrayal set me back, further back than when she met me. Justice may be blind, but luckily for me, it's not deaf. When the judge heard the recording of Haley's conversation with Lonnie, he ruled in my favor. No 50-50 split, no alimony. Haley was allowed to withdraw the same amount from our account that she brought into the marriage, keep her clothes and the engagement ring. Haley tried a few times to talk to me, even tried the old ploy of refusing to sign the divorce papers until I sat down with her. I told her to go duck herself and I'd wait the full year for the divorce even if she didn't sign. She ended up accosting me outside my workplace, shoving an envelope in my hand. She turned and walked away, but I called out to her, "Haley." She turned. I held the envelope in my hands above my head and ripped it in two, tossing the two halves in the air. Last I heard, Haley quit Donovan's and moved to the coast with Lonnie. I've heard bad things comes in threes, it did for me. My wife cheats on me, my therapist retires, and the coop dead end. The company I work for gets bought out and I get a pink slip. Oh, they gave me a couple months severance and the promise of a good recommendation. But I really liked my job and I didn't receive one decent offer in response to the 200 resumes I mailed out. I was getting desperate. I had money, but I didn't have anything in my life to help get me up in the morning besides the hours I spent in the gym. There must have been a dark cloud hanging over my head because the two or three women I met at the gym all declined my offer to buy them a cup of coffee. 5 months after the divorce and 3 months after my layoff, I caught a break. A computer company out of Arizona, Bibliotecna, was looking for a salesman for the Midwest region. It was a commission-based compensation package selling their systems. They would train me on the system, but everything after that was strictly up to me. Researching the potential customers, making cold calls, my travel expenses, training the customer after the system was installed, the whole ball of wax, it was either sell or starve. No one else was banging down my door to hire me. And with every week that went by without a job, I was getting more depressed, spending more time sitting on a bar stool, so I decided, duck it and took the job. Update 3. The following paragraph may sound as if I'm bragging, but you need to know something about what I look like in order to understand this next phase of my life. I'm 6'1 and in great shape from spending 5 days in the gym every week. I have my father's dark, Mediterranean skin and my mother's deep blue Nordic eyes. I have a full head of hair. When I'm not depressed, that puts people, and especially ladies, at ease. I spent the next 3 years putting these assets to work. I sold library computer systems, monitors, servers and the software to mid-sized town and county libraries. I'm ashamed to admit, the hardware equipment was cheap Chinese and the software wasn't much better. How did I get away with selling this? Well, if you know anything about libraries, you know that most libraries are managed by women. Women are on the library boards and the libraries themselves are staffed almost exclusively by women. I did my research, it took time, but I knew when I came into a town that there was a decent chance, almost 50-50, that I'd be leaving within a couple weeks with a sale worth at least $200,000 for my employer and a commission for a fifth of the sale. I was a great salesman with few scruples and I wasn't above seducing one or more ladies to make the sale. I can make all kinds of excuses, give 100 justifications for my behavior, but the truth is, I had lost my bearings and moral compass. I was careful in one respect. Didn't want a lot of hairy Kalinas growing up throughout the Midwest. And maybe a few of my conquests actually got as much out of our affair as I got out of it. I mean, some of these women were okay to look at. Some probably never had a date in the past 10 years. Only a few were what anyone would consider to be attractive. So, maybe having a brief fling with a good-looking guy would be a highlight for them. They were all adults. They all knew I was a traveling salesman and I never promised to change my life for any of them. I did regret that the systems I sold would be worthless in a few years. The monitors and servers probably had a lifespan of 4 or 5 years, tops, and the software support they received was less than desirable. I probably had another year before the first systems I sold would start to fail. Then I'd have to find a new line of work. The internet makes information too readily available. Bad reviews will start to crop up and it will be next to impossible to sell garbage, no matter how good the salesman. I pulled into the mid-sized Indiana town of Polk, just across the border from Illinois. It was the middle of summer and, even though it was 11 in the morning, it was hotter and the humidity made it intolerable. I arrived with plenty of time to spare. My appointment with the head librarian, the director Marion Howard, wasn't until 1 o'clock, so I pulled into Denny's to get something cold to drink. The air conditioning felt good and it would help keep me from sweating through my white shirt. I used the time to chat up the waitress, trying to get a little gossip about the town and such. Since it was a half hour before the lunch crowd, Alice wasn't busy and turned out to be a wealth of information. Alice filled the sugar bowls and salt shakers as I sat at the counter and listened. I could have paid a pie $1,000 and not gotten half of what Alice gave me for a $2 tip. I learned about the mayor's affair with his admin, about the mayor's wife and her attempts to even the score by screwing the guy who owns the bakery. All good gossip, but nothing that could help me. Neither the mayor, his wife, nor the baker were on the library board of trustees. But I did learn something. It seems Ms. Marion Howard is a widow. The Howards had one son, who Ms. Howard was raising with the help of her mother-in-law. Best of all, Marion Howard wasn't dating anyone. I parked my car in front of the library and checked myself in the visor mirror. I smiled at my own image and said to myself, "Showtime." I grabbed my briefcase and ran up the steps and into a whole different understanding of myself. I clearly wasn't ready for who greeted me when I walked into Ms. Howard's office that afternoon. She rose from her chair and reached over the large oak desk to shake my hand. She had a face as beautiful as any Hollywood starlet. "Mr. Kalina, it's a pleasure to finally meet you." My confusion over her welcome obviously registered on my face because she immediately explained herself. "I'm very good friends with Ms. Rose Peters, the directing librarian in Falls Junction, Iowa. Rose and I were roommates at U of I." This was not good. Rose Peters happened to be one of my previous conquests, sometime during the previous year. I might still have a chance at making a sale, though. The Falls Junction system was still new and still functioning. Best of all, I think Rose and I parted on pretty good terms. Marion continued to stun me with her straightforward approach. "Do you think we can dispense with the seduction and concentrate on what your system can do to modernize our library?" Marion Howard said this with a slight smile on her lips, but what I really noticed was how her eyes twinkled as she smiled. Without being too obvious and still looking into those beautiful blue eyes, my peripheral vision took in the fact that this woman had an incredibly sexy body. For the next 2 hours, Marion told me exactly what she needed to accomplish the library board of trustees' goals. I did my best to convince Marion that the Bibliotechna system was state-of-the-art and would meet all her library's need for the next decade. Marion listened to the pitch, asked tough questions. There were questions I couldn't answer. I promised to get back to her the next day after talking to the head office. We didn't even touch on price and I was already sweating. We broke off the meeting. I was heading out the door, on my way to the motel so I could get on the phone with Phoenix, when Marion surprised me. "It must be difficult being on the road all the time, eating in restaurants. Would you care to join me and my family for a home-cooked meal? My mother-in-law is an excellent cook. I'd love it, but I do need to call the office. Here's our address. We'll have dinner at 6. If you change your mind, call me here before 5. Otherwise, show up anytime after 5:15. I walked out of the library shaking my head. Librarians are generally very nice people, but not nearly as friendly as Ms. Howard. I laughed at myself. Who was playing who? Was the prim librarian setting me up for some super discount by feeding me a home-cooked meal? I went to my motel room, made my calls to Phoenix, and asked them to email the answers before my follow-up meeting with Marion the next afternoon, then washed up and put on a casual shirt. The Howard home was something out of the last century, sometime before the Second World War, everything but a white picket fence. It was a white craftsman with a nice covered porch around the front and one side. The front yard was filled with flowering shrubs. There was even an American flag flying from one of the posts. A woman in her 60s, but with the movement of a trained athlete, came out the front screen door as soon as I approached the walk with my obligatory bouquet of flowers and bottle of wine. "You must be Mr. Kalina. What a pleasure. Marion is upstairs changing. She's running a little late. She asked me if I'd entertain you for a minute. I'm Audrey Howard, Marion's mother-in-law." Before I could say a word, Audrey hooked her arm in mine and pulled me toward the house. As we walked up the front steps, she asked, "What can I get you, Mr. Kalina? A beer, iced tea, open your wine, or maybe a cocktail? I make a mean Manhattan. Please, Ms. Howard, call me Harry. I could use a beer." "Well, then you must call me Audrey. I'll be right back with the beer. Sit down." Audrey floated out of the room. That's the only way to describe the way this woman moved. She came back with a bottle and a glass. "Poured." "Yes, please." She poured the beer in the glass and handed it to me before turning to make herself a drink from the small liquor cabinet. "Rose Peters visited us last Easter and had so many nice things to say about you. Marion and I couldn't wait to meet you. How's the beer?" "I only had pale ale in the fridge." "I hope that's all right." "It's perfect." I felt like I'd fallen into some kind of Twilight Zone episode. Rose had obviously shared some details of our relationship with both Audrey and Marion. But how much detail? I nervously looked around the room until my eyes landed on the framed photo of a handsome man in a uniform. Audrey's eyes followed mine. "That's my son Ron, Marion's late husband. He was a state trooper who died last year. My first wife was dead in an auto accident when another driver ran a red light. She was pregnant with our first child. Audrey looked at me with sympathy in her eyes. Isn't it just so hard? I don't know how Marion will do it, raising young Ronnie on her own. She has you, only until Ronnie starts school in the fall, full-day kindergarten. I'll be moving back to Florida. I have a boyfriend who's been very patient these past 15 months while I've been here. My thoughts were interrupted when Marion walked in the room wearing a nice pair of shorts and a short-sleeve white shirt. Hi, Harry. Thanks for coming. I see Mom got you a beer. I'm going to get myself an iced tea. I didn't have a chance to reply before she skipped out of the room. Audrey said, I'll go check on dinner. I hope you like pasta with gravy. Gravy? Oh, it's a tomato sauce. Where I grew up, everyone calls spaghetti sauce gravy. Well, I'm half Italian, so spaghetti and gravy sounds great. Audrey left the room and Marion walked in. Audrey had the radio on in the kitchen. I thought we could talk without being overheard. Marion, you and Audrey seem to know more than I'm comfortable about my relationship with Rose. Don't worry about Mom. She doesn't know about the sex part. She just knows you two dated and Rose said she enjoyed your time together. Yes, she told me you two were intimate, but no details, don't worry. Rose did tell me how you helped her get over the terrible self-respect issues she was having after her divorce, said if a guy like you could show such interest in her, that she must be prettier and have more going for her than she thought. Her husband left her for some female. After you left town, she was happy when you sent a couple letters, writing how much you enjoyed the time with her. She actually started dating and is now engaged to a very nice, handsome, successful doctor. She claims she owes it all to you. The way Marion put it, I started to think that maybe I wasn't as big and as tall as I thought. It's true, I did use seduction as part of my sales pitch, but I did try to leave each lady with a sense that our time together meant something. And it was especially easy with Rose. She was a fantastic lady. And I always followed each sale with at least one letter and a bouquet of roses. I spent the next 20 minutes listening to tales of Marion's time at school when she was Rose's roommate. Marion shared a few funny stories before Audrey stuck her head in the room. Dinner in 5 minutes, Ronnie needs to come home and wash up. Marion pulled her cell phone out of her back pocket. Sue, hi, can you send Ronnie home? Marion listened, kind of blushed, lowered her voice and answered a question. No, he's a traveling salesman trying to sell the library a computer system. I invited him over for one of Mom's meals. Cut it out. Marion pressed end on her phone and looked at me, embarrassed. My neighbor saw you pull up and thinks you're cute. Before the end of this evening, all the neighborhood gossips will be picking up their phones and talking about the man in my house. Sometimes small town living can be over the top. I chuckled my reply to Marion's observation. I grew up in Chicago and now I spend most of my time in small towns. I can see the advantages and disadvantages in both. I don't know about city life, but after Ron died, it was nice to have the support of so many neighbors and the community. So I'll take the little bit of bad with all the good. Just then a small hurricane came roaring into the house. He stopped and stared. Who's this? Ronnie, this is Mr. Colina. He's our guest for dinner tonight. Harry, this is my son, Ronnie. We shook hands and exchanged highs before Marion told Ronnie to go wash his hands for dinner. Dinner was excellent. Spaghetti and meatballs with garlic bread. Not only the meal, but the entire atmosphere was superb. I couldn't remember the last time I sat down for a family dinner. Ronnie was a sharp 5-year-old. He was disappointed to learn the Bears are my favorite football team and not his beloved Colts. He brightened up when I told him the Colts beat my beloved Bears in Super Bowl 41 a few years before he was born. I learned more about Audrey's boyfriend in Tampa, a 68-year-old ex-steelworker who was currently building a house for the two of them. Audrey wasn't supposed to know that Daniel planned to propose marriage as soon as she returned from Indiana. He's building the house on spec. He doesn't know if you're going to accept his proposal. I think he knows, but in any case, it gives him something to do. He hates golf and his knees won't hold up to tennis. He reads books, but can only sit still for a few hours at a time. It doesn't matter anyway, I'm going to say yes. I love the guy. I related some stories growing up in Chicago, but stayed away from anything related to my two marriages, trying to keep the conversation light. After dinner, Ronnie asked me to play catch with his Andrew Luck signature youth football. We went into the backyard and tossed the ball back and forth while discussing his favorite movies and TV shows, none of which I knew. I did my best to appear interested. After a half hour, I figured it was time to go. I thanked everyone for a great meal and headed off to my motel. It took me a couple of hours to fall asleep, staring at the TV and then the ceiling. Something was happening to me. I was thinking of Marion less as a conquest and more as a woman I'd like to get to know. At 1 the following afternoon, I was back at Marion's desk. She greeted me with a smile. We sat down and went over the answers I received from the head office to yesterday's questions. Then I gave her an estimate of how much the system would cost. I'd submit a formal proposal within a week. Harry, I have to ask, how is it the Bibliotechna system is so much less than the other proposals I've received from your competitors? Even the high end of the estimate you just quoted is $50,000 less than the next lowest bid. I can't afford to make a mistake here. The library board of trustees already think I'm over my head. If I don't recommend the right system, I'll be out of a job and I need this job. I must be out of my head because the next words out of my mouth couldn't come from a sane man. Then don't accept our proposal. You might get 3 good years out of our hardware, 4 or 5, if you're lucky. After a few years, you'll notice more failures and you'll get lousy customer support from our call center in India. What about the difference in price? My board will wonder why I didn't pick the lowest cost supplier. I'll raise the price. That way you won't need to justify choosing another vendor. Why would you do that? Because I'm tired of selling this, tired of selling my soul. I let the bad things that happened to me turn me into someone I can't recognize. You obviously didn't allow your husband's death to turn your soul inside out. I'm quitting this job right after I write your proposal. You'll get our bid tomorrow, and it won't be any less than what you already have received from the others. I stood up, suddenly needing to leave her office. Thanks for dinner last night and thanks for sharing your table. Thank your mother-in-law, too. Tell her I wish her all the best when she marries that guy in Tampa. Give your son a hug. He's going to be a fine young man. As I left her office, she called out, "Bye, Harry. Good luck." Update 4. I gave Bibliotechna my notice of resignation. They weren't pleased since I was one of their 2 top salesmen. They only lasted another 2 years anyways. Equipment was failing and another well-established company selling a superior library system sued them for having a similar name and infringing on some patents. It ended in Bibliotechna going bankrupt and shutting its doors. I went home and looked at my apartment. It wasn't a bad place to live while I was on the road over half the time, but it would sure to live here full time. I thought about what I should do to make a living. I didn't need to hurry with over $1 million in my accounts. I thought about where I should live. I sat in my one decent piece of furniture, the leather recliner Gwen gave me on our 5th anniversary. I thought back to how she used to snuggle in my lap in this chair as we talked about the future, our dreams and our fantasies. We once played the wishing game. What would you be if you could be anything in the world? Gwen's wish was to be a mother. My wish was to be a professional baseball player, preferably the second baseman for the Chicago Cubs. Gwen rebuked me. No, it has to be something realistic. What? You're saying I'm not good enough to play for the Cubs? I'm saying I've watched enough of your softball games to know you'll never turn the double play if one of those guys comes sliding in high. Well, she was right about that, so no use arguing the point. Now I had to come up with a different fantasy occupation. My second choice was Indy race car driver. But our conversation that evening reminded me of another dream I had. If I had the money and the know-how, I would love to restore vintage automobiles or be a tech on a racing crew. Gwen was surprised. Really, cars? I never knew you had an interest. How could I not know that about you? Probably because I left that dream behind after my 3rd year in college. Throughout high school, and for the first 2 years at college, I worked part-time in a garage, doing simple stuff, changing oil, tune-ups, simple repairs. Then, after my junior year, when I got an internship at Merrill Lynch, I turned into the broker weenie, Mr. Suit and Tie that you met and married. My grease monkey days got left behind. Gwen laughed. This explains why you get that dreamy look in your eyes whenever one of those Italian sports cars ride by. If it was a woman, I'd be jealous at the way you stare. So, how come we don't have a fancier car? I had to think about this before I could answer Gwen. Probably because if I can't own one of those, I don't care to own what's in second place. So, I just as soon own the Toyota sedan that's sitting out in the garage. Does that make sense? Besides, if we're going to have kids, a 2-seater won't cut it. Gwen gave me a hug. Thanks, Harry, I love you. Gwen didn't have to say it. We were going to make her fantasy career come true. She would be pregnant before the end of the year. Roughly 4 years after that conversation, I'm sitting in that same chair, thinking back to that wonderful evening. It took every ounce of willpower I had. I wanted to get up and grab the bottle of Jim Beam sitting in the cupboard. Instead, I thought, why not? I have the money, the time, no obligations. Best of all, I still have the desire. So, why not? And, as it turned out, I have the aptitude. I enrolled at a technical school near Atlanta. All my worldly possessions, including my leather recliner, went into storage outside Chicago. I stayed in a furnished, one-room apartment for the 18 months while I was in school. Then I ended up in Phoenix, 8 months working as an apprentice with an outfit that restored high-end cars mostly for all the newly minted millionaires working for high-tech companies in Silicon Valley. I had to laugh at some of these guys. Many had never driven a manual transmission with a clutch, and here they were pulling out of our shop driving $250,000 vehicles, capable of a couple hundred mph. We made a bundle offering the option to give lessons on driving a stick shift. During the last month of my apprenticeship, a wealthy gentleman, the CEO of a steel company that just happens to sponsor an Indy car, came into the shop with his 25-year-old bride. They recently purchased a red 1997 Ferrari F355 Spider she just had to have. The trouble was, the thing wouldn't run right, and neither of the first two mechanics they contacted had a clue why. His own racing team's mechanics couldn't take the time because it was in the middle of the race season. Someone suggested they bring it to Phoenix. The car was on a trailer towed behind their Escalade. Carlos, who would typically diagnose this model, was visiting his parents in Palm Springs. Damien, who backed up Carlos, was in the hospital with his wife after her water broke 2 weeks early. It fell upon the lowly apprentice to check the car in, take the pertinent information, and inform the owners that it would be at least a week before either Carlos or Damien would be back to look it over. Mr. and Mrs. Steele, CEO, left after I unhitched the trailer, both looking quite peeved at the turn of events. Their plan was to spend a few days at Saddleback while we diagnosed and fixed the problem, then get back on the road to their vacation home in Sedona. These were people accustomed to hearing the response, "How high?" When they said, "Jump," I offloaded the Ferrari from the trailer, got it in an open bay, and just for kicks, decided to stay and look it over after everyone else left for the night. This was old school stuff, working with gauges and meters, no plugging into a computer and running a diagnostic program. After a few hours, I was certain I found the issue, but only because I had Carlo's notes on a similar issue with a car he restored 8 years prior. I made the adjustments following Carlo's notes. By now it was past midnight, but it seemed like a perfect time to take a test drive. I spent the 5 miles getting to I-10 warming it up, then took the westbound ramp. 10 miles west of the city, I opened it up, but kept it under 90. At exit 69 I turned around, drove east to exit 81, keeping my eyes open. At exit 81 I turned around once more and went west again. This time I let the Ferrari loose, slowing down to 90 only the 3 times I passed drivers heading in the same direction. No need to give anyone a heart attack. I made the 12 miles between exits in just under 5 minutes. Back in the shop, I texted the owner, "Your Ferrari is ready to pick up." My boss was a little bit pleased the next morning when I filled him in. He almost smiled when he said, "Ducking showboat." He did smile when he wrote up the invoice for $1,275. He was ready to send me home just as the owners pulled in. When Mr. CEO found out I was an apprentice who would be looking for a permanent position within a month, he gave me his card with his head mechanic's name on it and told me to call him. Nothing came of that first call, but the next year I received a call when they needed a temp to fill in for another mechanic. I was working in the pits 2 days before the big race at the Brickyard. Our car had finished its practice laps an hour earlier, and we were completing a few tweaks our driver recommended. As I got up to stretch my muscles, I heard someone call my name. "Harry Colina." I turned to the sound and saw her beautiful face. Standing beside her was Audrey, and beside Audrey, a 70-year-old mountain of a man. "Marion, what a surprise." "Audrey, you're looking beautiful, as always." I held up my greasy hands to signal why I wasn't offering to shake hands or hug. Audrey smiled at my compliment. "Harry, this is my husband, Daniel Morrison." "Daniel, Harry used to sell library computer systems and now it seems he works on race cars. Quite a transition, Harry. I'd love to hear how that came about. I could buy you dinner tonight and tell you. I still owe you for the delicious pasta and gravy meal we shared with Ronnie." I looked at Marion. "How is your son doing? He must be 8 by now." Marion's smile only grew brighter. "What a memory you have. Ronnie just turned 8 last month. He's at home with my parents. They came up from Tucson so I could go to the races with Mom and Daniel. It's my first time at Indy." Audrey filled in the blanks. "Daniel comes at least every other year. His old boss has a suite and still invites Daniel. That's how we got these pit passes. We decided Marion should do it upright with the entire experience. What luck to run into you. I have to finish up here. Will you join me for dinner? It will have to be a little late. I'll be working until 6, then it takes at least an hour to get clean and deodorized. Where are you staying?" Daniel got a word in edgewise. "The Hyatt Regency. We can eat in their dining room. If that's all right, we'll make reservations for 8. We made the final arrangements before they left to get some autographs and souvenirs. I went back to work. Dinner that evening reminded me why I enjoyed sitting down for a meal with this family. Daniel seemed to take the place of Ronnie as a lubricant for conversation. He told some great tales and kept the three of us laughing. I learned a little bit more about Marion's early years. Told them how I came to find myself on the pit crew for one of the indie teams. Had to confess that I was a substitute for one of the crew whose father had taken seriously ill, and that I'd be looking for another job before the end of June, if not sooner. Confessed I had some money saved up and wouldn't mind opening my own shop someday. It was just a matter of finding the right place to settle down. No finer place than Florida, was Daniel's opinion. The guy really loved the Sunshine State. We finished dinner, and I needed to get back to get some sleep. Tomorrow was the race, and it wouldn't do if I wasn't well rested. We exchanged email addresses and phone numbers before I grabbed a cab back to my hotel. Racing is an interesting pursuit. I wonder why so many companies and individuals get involved by owning a car and competing at the championship level. There are thousands of components to each car. A good majority of these components can fail, and when there's a failure, the car doesn't finish the race. Then there are the drivers. You can have a great driver who may make a single mistake during the 200 laps, which will change the outcome from a podium to a crash. Then, of course, there are the 32 other cars and drivers all vying to keep your car and driver off the podium. The worst-case scenario is when another driver does something stupid or irresponsible and ends your race by crashing into your car. That Sunday afternoon, everything went our way. The car performed beautifully. Our driver kept his cool and drove wonderfully. It was magic. We came in second, our first podium that season. Only one black cloud interrupted my feeling of euphoria. The guy I was substituting for came back Monday morning, ready to get back on the team. I got my last paycheck, a decent bonus, and a pat on the back. I probably would have missed the race. The guy tried to get back Saturday, but all the flights into Indianapolis were booked solid until that Monday morning. I did get a nice email from Marion, congratulating me on our second place finish, and hoping we had another chance to get together again. It was signed, "Your friend, Marion," which meant a lot to me. I stopped by the Hyatt Monday after finishing up at the track, but she had checked out. I considered traveling to Polk, but thought I was being stupid. I was now an unemployed mechanic with nothing but a feeling that maybe Marion and I connected on some level. She is beautiful, charming, smart, and has an aura about her that made me want to know her better, but for some reason I just couldn't take the chance again. What if she doesn't think of me as anything other than a friend? Could I stand the heartbreak a third time? Final update, I decided, headed down to Florida. Spent a long weekend with Audrey and Daniel. Daniel took me out on his boat and we spent a great day fishing, drinking, and sharing life stories. I headed down to the Keys and up to Miami, where I found a great job. I was working for a high-end dealer of used luxury automobiles down in Miami. The Phoenix Garage gave me an excellent reference, and this dealer hired me on the spot. All these nouveau-rich professional athletes and pop stars hung out with the other beautiful people on South Beach, and they all needed an expensive automobile to pull up to the nightclubs and restaurants on Ocean Drive. We sold them used $100,000 cars. I made certain the cars performed. I'd been working there for 3 months when I received an email from Marion. There were two attachments. One was a screen print of an ad from Polk's weekly newspaper. For sale, turnkey business, auto and service station. Includes building and all equipment for servicing older model and current models, foreign and domestic. Owner, operator retiring. One current mechanic plus one receptionist, both anxious to stay with business. Price negotiable. Excellent business opportunity. Solid customer base in mid-sized town. Serious inquiries only. Contact Jason Martin, Addy, broker at dot dot dot. The text of the email read, "Dear Harry, I've written and rewritten the letter below because I don't know how you feel about me. We've only had 2 evenings together and never alone, those and the 2 meetings in my office. But every time I look at you, I see you looking back at me, and I think it's a look of something more than just lust. I never told you how much I appreciate what you did for me. By refusing to sell what you called a cheap system, you probably saved my job. I know you lost a commission by doing it. I also know you contacted Rose and helped her renegotiate the terms of her contract. She used the money to upgrade the servers and some of the monitors. Thank you from both of us. I'm a 34-year-old mother with an 8-year-old son. I'm not looking for a man to support me because I have a good job in my own home. I probably want to have another child, maybe two. I like living in Polk, and I think you'd like it here, too. I remembered you saying you would like to own your own auto shop. Don't know if you can afford the shop here in town, but I thought you should know it's for sale. I have a friend at the local bank. Maybe I can put in a good word for you and she can help secure a loan. Maybe I'm getting a little ahead of myself here, but let me just come right out with it. I would like you to move here and give us a chance to get to know one another. I already know you are a wonderful man, You are kind and honest. I think we can be friends and I hope we can become lovers. There, I said it. I want you to move here, fall in love with me and be my husband. You may think this is extremely naive of me, practically proposing to a man who I've only been with a few times. But I have to confess to the fact that Audrey and Daniel shared much of what they learned about you when you stayed with them last summer. I know about Gwen and Haley and why you're still single at 36. I know you want to settle down someday and have children, but only with the right woman. They shared all that and they encouraged me to write you this letter. Of course, you'll have to share me with Ronnie and you'd have to love Ronnie like a son, but you already know that. So, let me know if there is anything else you need to know to convince you to at least give us a try. This is the most insane thing I've ever done in my life, but isn't being in love some kind of insanity? All my love, Marion. The second attachment to the email was a photo of Marion and Ronnie standing on their front porch, both of them smiling at the camera. I called Jason Martin, the broker handling the sale of the repair shop. I asked him to overnight the prospectus and all the recent tax filings and at the same time made plans to come up the following weekend to review the business and property. The asking price was well within my means. I'd still have most of my funds for any subsequent expenditures. I called Marion and told her I would be in town and asked if we could have a real date, just the two of us, while I was in town. I didn't tell her I was in town to look at the shop. No need to build up expectations. You can call it anything you like. The truth of the matter is, I was already in love with Marion, but we did need to spend some time together to know if we could be more than friends. 3 months later, we've come back full circle to the first paragraph of this story. I'm sitting on the back deck of the house I rent here in Polk, Indiana, looking east at the sunrise as I sip coffee from my special souvenir cup. In my other hand is a photograph of Gwen. She was one of the loveliest women you would ever meet. I know in my heart that if Gwen and Marion ever met, they would have liked one another. What's especially hard to believe is one man could have two beautiful women with such wonderful qualities fall in love with him. I can hear Audrey and Daniel getting up inside the house. I asked them to come up from Tampa to share in today's events. Marion doesn't know they are in town. Later today, I'll be asking Marion to marry me. The ring is sitting on the kitchen table. I showed it to Audrey and she agrees. Marion is going to love it. The plan is to have Marion and Ronnie over for lunch and greet her at the front door while I have one knee on the floor. I'll ask her to marry me and then Audrey and Daniel will make their appearance from the kitchen. I'm thinking this will be a good day. Yes, in the last 3 months I did buy the shop. I did date Marion and I did confirm we would be friends, lovers and good parents to Ronnie and hopefully to more children soon. Oh, by the way, Marion said yes and we lived happily ever after. The end. Thank you for being a part of our journey and we look forward to sharing more powerful stories with you in the future. We encourage you to subscribe to our channel and stay connected with our community. Remember, this channel exists because of your support, and I want it to be a place where we can all come together, learn, and have a great time. Your feedback is vital, and I appreciate every single suggestion and comment you provide. Take care yourself and see you soon.